In the Vault by H.P. Lovecraft. There is nothing more absurd, as I view it, than that conventional association of the homely and the wholesome which seems to pervade the psychology of the multitude. Mention a bucolic Yankee setting, a bungling and thick-fibered village undertaker, and a careless mishap in a tomb, and no average reader can be brought to expect more than a hearty, albeit grotesque, phase of comedy. God knows, though, that the chilling tale which George Birch's death permits me to tell has in it aspects beside which some of our darkest tragedies are light. Birch acquired a limitation and changed his business in 1881, yet never discussed the case when he could avoid it. Neither did his old physician, Dr. Davis, who died years ago. It was generally stated that the affliction and shock were results of an unlucky slip, whereby Birch had locked himself for 9 hours in the receiving tomb of Peck Valley Cemetery, escaping only by a crude and disastrous means. But while this much was undoubtedly true, there were other and blacker things which the man used to whisper to me in his drunken delirium toward the last. He confided in me because I was his doctor, and because he probably felt the need of confiding in someone else after Davis died. Birch, before 1881, had been the village undertaker of Peck Valley, and was a very calloused and primitive specimen, even as such specimens go. The practices I heard attributed to him would be unbelievable today, at least in a city, and even Peck Valley would have shuddered a bit had it known the easy ethics of its mortuary artist in such debatable matters as the ownership of costly laying-out apparel invisible beneath a casket's lid, and the degree of dignity to be maintained in posing and adapting the lifeless tenants in containers not always calculated with sublimest accuracy. Most distinctly, Birch was lax, insensitive, and professionally undesirable. Yet I still think he was not an evil man. He was merely crass, often full of liquor, thoughtless, and careless, as his easily avoidable accident proves, and without that modicum of imagination which holds the average citizen within certain limits fixed by taste. Just where to begin Birch's story, I can hardly decide, since I am no practiced teller of tales. I suppose one should start in the cold December of 1880, when the ground froze and the cemetery delvers found they could dig no more graves till spring. Fortunately, the village was small and the death rate low, so that it was possible to give all of Birch's inanimate charges a temporary haven in the single antiquated receiving tomb. The undertaker grew doubly lethargic in the bitter weather and seemed to outdo even himself in carelessness. Never did he knock together flimsier and ungainlier caskets, nor disregard more flagrantly the needs of the rusty lock on the tomb door, which he slammed open and shut with such nonchalant abandon. At last, the spring thaw came, and graves were laboriously prepared for the 9 silent harvests of the grim reaper, which waited in the tomb. Birch, though dreading the bother of removal and interment, began his task of transference one disagreeable April morning, but ceased before noon because of a heavy rain that seemed to irritate his horse, after having laid but one mortal tenement to its permanent rest. That was Darius Peck, whose grave was not far from the tomb. Birch decided he would begin the next day with little old Matthew Fenner, whose grave was also nearby. On the afternoon of Good Friday, then, April 15th, Birch set out for the tomb with horse and wagon to transfer the body of Matthew Fenner. That he was not perfectly sober, he subsequently admitted, though he had not then taken to the wholesale drinking by which he later tried to forget certain things. He was just dizzy and careless enough to annoy his sensitive horse, which, as he drew it viciously up at the tomb, neighed and pawed and tossed its head, much as on that former occasion when the rain had vexed it. The day was clear, but a high wind had sprung up, and Birch was glad to get to shelter as he unlocked the iron door and entered the side hill vault. Another might not have relished the damp, odorous chamber with the 8 carelessly placed coffins. But Birch, in those days, was insensitive, and was concerned only in getting the right coffin for the right grave. He had not forgotten the criticism aroused when Hannah Bixby's relatives, wishing to transport her body to the cemetery in the city whither they had moved, found the casket of Judge Capwell beneath her headstone. The light was dim, but Birch's sight was good, and he did not get Asaph Sawyer's coffin by mistake, although it was very similar. He had indeed made that coffin for Matthew Fenner, but had cast it aside at last as too awkward and flimsy, in a fit of curious sentimentality aroused by recalling how kindly and generous the little old man had been to him during his bankruptcy 5 years before. He gave old Matt the very best his skill could produce, but was thrifty enough to save the rejected specimen and to use it when Asaph Sawyer died of a malignant fever. Sawyer was not a lovable man, and many stories were told of his almost inhuman vindictiveness and tenacious memory for wrongs real or fancied. To him, Birch had felt no compunction in assigning the carelessly made coffin, which he now pushed out of the way in his quest for the Fenner casket. It was just as he had recognized old Matt's coffin that the door slammed to in the wind, leaving him in the dusk even deeper than before.